Welcome, everyone. Thank you so much for joining us as we introduce an exciting new project, the Santa Fe Pollinator Trail, that we've been working on behind the scenes for months, along with many amazing partner organizations and individuals across Santa Fe County. This project is a coordinated effort to create connected, climate-resilient habitat for pollinators across urban Santa Fe, connecting the outer pollinator habitat that surrounds Santa Fe with the inner, more developed areas of urban Santa Fe. So if you live in Santa Fe, we're hoping that you'll help us bridge the gaps for pollinators and help support and conserve the diversity of Santa Fe's bees and butterflies and other pollinators in yards and gardens and parks across the city. That's all what Kaitlin will be introducing as we launch this project today. But before we get started, I did want to take care of a little bit of webinar housekeeping. So this webinar will be recorded. It's currently being recorded and will be publicly available on the Xerces YouTube channel in about a week, where you can come back and refer to it or share it with friends. We have the chat function in Zoom turned off because it can be a little distracting during the course of the presentation, but we absolutely encourage you to ask questions using the Q&A function at the bottom of the screen. So feel free to ask questions anytime during the webinar and we'll come back and answer those at the end. I also wanted to point out that there is closed captioning available during this webinar. Thank you for joining us, Brooke. Brooke will be providing live captioning for the webinar, which you can toggle on and off at the bottom of your screen by clicking the closed caption button and then show subtitles or hide subtitles. So with that, we'll get started. So just to start us off here, the Xerces Society is a member-supported nonprofit organization. And I would like to give a special thanks to Xerces Society members who make our work possible, and would also like to thank the Carol Petrie Foundation, which helps fund the work that Xerces is doing in Santa Fe and across the Southwest US to support and conserve pollinators. So thank you so much for making this work possible. If you're not familiar with us as an organization, Xerces Society is an international organization dedicated to protecting wildlife through the conservation of invertebrates and their habitat. Invertebrates are animals without a spine or backbone, like snails and freshwater mussels, as well as the many insects around us, like bees and butterflies and dragonflies. Invertebrates make up 94% of all species on Earth and contribute to all kinds of natural processes and ecosystem services like pollination, seed dispersal, decomposition, as well as being the base of many, many food webs. Xerces is named for the Xerces blue butterfly, which is the butterfly species, the first butterfly species thought to have gone extinct in North America through human activities. It was found in sand dunes in San Francisco. And since 1971, we've been working through a variety of different programs to protect wildlife. We have regional offices across the country. We recently, last year, added New Mexico to that list. And we work to provide invertebrates with habitat, to conserve invertebrates across a variety of settings. We have a big program in pollinators and agricultural biodiversity, as well as programs in endangered species and aquatic invertebrates, pesticides, as well as now urban conservation and community outreach. So with that, I will just introduce Kaitlin, who's going to be leading us through this launch of the Santa Fe Pollinator Trail. Kaitlin is our Southwest Pollinator Conservation Specialist. She joined us last year to take on this new role in Santa Fe, where she collaborates with public and private land managers, other organizations, and the public to encourage pollinator-friendly practices for landscaping and gardening and open space restoration. She also promotes pollinator awareness and conservation across New Mexico communities. She holds a master's degree in environmental science and policy from Northern Arizona University, where she studied impacts of drying on aquatic invertebrate diversity. And before graduate school, she worked in ecological science and restoration for 5 years in a whole bunch of different systems. So we're excited for her to be with us and excited for her to introduce us to the Santa Fe Pollinator Trail. So take it away, Kaitlin.
All right. Thanks so much, Emily. Thank you for that introduction and covering all the housekeeping details of Zoom. And I'm really excited that you all have joined us today to talk about the Pollinator Trail and learn more about how you can get involved in pollinator conservation in Santa Fe. And to start, I just want to talk about how important pollinators are. So pollinators are critical to the reproduction of many plant species and are therefore critical to the function of the planet. And while some flowering plants like grasses and oak trees are pollinated by wind, more than 85% of flowering plants require an animal to move their pollen from one flower to another. And these pollen-moving creatures are called pollinators and include some vertebrates like hummingbirds and bats, but the vast majority are insects like bees and butterflies. And because pollinators are essential to the reproduction of so many kinds of plants, they are also essential to the production of the fruits and seeds that we eat. So 35% of global crop production relies on animal pollinators. The crops that rely on pollinators include some of our most nutritious and delicious foods, including things like berries, apples, avocados, squash, almonds, coffee, and chocolate, and many, many more. So we really have pollinators to thank for a lot of nutritious foods that put color on our plate and also are some of our favorite vices like chocolate and coffee. Since pollinators are essential for so many plants to reproduce, they also help maintain populations of wild plants and help them produce the seeds and fruits that are major food sources for wildlife. And not only do they help produce those plant food sources, the pollinators themselves are critical to the diets of many wildlife species, including birds, mammals, fish, and even other insects. So thanks to the role of pollinators in plant reproduction and as food themselves for many wildlife species, pollinators really help make up the base of the food chain. Now I mentioned that there are some vertebrates that pollinate like bats and birds and a few other vertebrates, but most movement of pollen between flowers is done by insect pollinators. And this includes insects that you probably already know of as pollinators, like bees and butterflies, but also other groups which may not immediately come to mind, like moths, wasps, beetles, and flies. And all of these different insects visit flowers to feed on nectar, and some of them feed on pollen. But female bees specifically visit flowers to collect lots of pollen to feed their offspring. And because of this, bees are the most efficient and important animal pollinator. They actively collect pollen and carry it around on their bodies. So as they collect pollen from different flowers, that means they're moving that pollen with them and creating greater pollination success compared to an insect that's just there to drink nectar and might pick up a few pollen grains. Bees are usually covered in pollen and are often really hairy and have different appendages for collecting that pollen. You can see this green sweat bee just has her hairy back legs are packed with pollen. Another reason bees are really excellent pollinators is that they exhibit flower constancy, which means once they collect pollen from a certain type of flower, they prefer to visit that same flower over and over again because they're familiar with it. They already know how to collect pollen from there. So that means they're transporting pollen from flowers to the same species of flowers over and over again, increasing successful pollination. And finally, bees forage in an area around a nest. So when they're concentrating all of their foraging visits to those that local population of plants, they're really increasing the seed set of the plants in that area. And when most people think of a bee, they usually think of a honeybee. But honeybees are a very atypical bee. They're not your typical bee. First off, honeybees are an introduced species from Europe, and they are not native to North America. They were brought here by colonists from Europe and live a very different life than most of our native bees. So honeybees are social, you're probably familiar. They live in large hives with a caste system, with a queen, worker bees, drones, and make up a colony. And this colony lives through the winter on honey stores in the hive, making them a perennial species that can live for a few years. They are also a really important agricultural species that we manage as humans and move them around to provide pollination and crop systems. And we also obviously harvest honey from them. So they are a major agricultural species. And while these bees are experiencing declines, they are not a threat of extinction like our native bees are. Most honeybee hives are maintained by beekeepers, and they are not a native species. So when we're talking about bee conservation, we're usually talking about the many native bees that live very different lives compared to honeybees. So looking at how diverse our native bees are, you might be surprised to see so much diversity in this world of bees. There are 3,600 species of bees in the US, and they vary hugely in their appearance, as well as their strategies for nesting, eating, and interacting with others of their species. Most of these bees are solitary. Around 70% of bee species don't have a social system. It's one single female bee taking care of her nest alone. Most of our species are solitary like this. And bees may either be generalist or specialist species. So honeybees, for example, are a generalist species. They're not picky about what plant species they collect from. And that goes for a lot of our native bee species as well. They're not very picky. They'll collect pollen from lots of different plant families and are able to utilize lots of different plant family resources. Whereas specialist bees are more picky about what pollen they feed their young. So they have evolved to only collect pollen from a certain family, genus, even species of plant. So they've become very dependent on the plants that they have evolved with. And an estimated about 35% of the 3,000 species of bees in the Western US are pollen specialist. So a lot of our bees are specialist, even more are solitary. They live pretty different lives than the honeybee you're probably familiar with. And just to give you an example of bee diversity, here is a bumblebee on the right, the big fuzzy bumblebee, and a little tiny solitary bee on the left, both collecting nectar pollen from the same thistle flower. Now, the bumblebee on the right is a species that is active from spring to fall and lives in a small colony. So they are active all year round and have a colony of a few hundred individuals, whereas many small solitary bee species live for just a few weeks out of the year. And as a solitary bee, it's just the female on her own collecting all the pollen for her own nest and her babies. Now, we usually see bees when they are visiting flowers and collecting pollen for their nest, but where do they nest? About 1% of native bees are bumblebees that nest in a social cavity, or they nest socially and are usually inside some sort of cavity in the ground. And that's about just the 1% of bumblebees of our total bee diversity live that way. And around 30% of our native bees live in stems or inside of tunnels and create a series of brood cells in those little cavities by laying an egg, placing a pollen ball, covering that up, and then doing the same thing again in the series to the end of the tunnel. And then the vast majority of bee species, about 70% of our native bees, will actually dig nest in the ground. They're ground nesting bees. And this is really especially true of bees in the desert. So ground nesting conditions are really, really great in arid systems. So we have a lot of ground nesting bees. So it's not just flowers that bees and insect pollinators need. They also need the right conditions for their type of nesting or overwintering behavior. Now, considering how important pollinators are to feeding the world, it is probably pretty alarming to hear these animals are in decline. Many insect pollinators, including a variety of native bees and many types of butterflies and moths, are currently experiencing declines in both abundance and diversity. So we're seeing fewer species and fewer individuals of even our common species. And our managed honeybees are also experiencing declines. And research is continuing to document these losses in our pollinator populations and the impact that has on plant communities that depend on pollinators. But why are we seeing these declines? The key risk factors for pollinator species are habitat loss, or the loss of resources and space pollinators need to complete their life cycles. Next is pesticide use, and that includes large-scale agricultural use, to the treatment of nursery plants, to home garden use in urban areas. Next is diseases and non-native species. The movement of honeybee colonies can spread disease. Also, management of native bees for pollination isn't really that well regulated, so there's disease transfer happening there. And then finally, climate change, which is especially threatening in the Southwest, as we are already seeing higher temperatures and more extreme droughts and even shifts in vegetation. So many of the causes of pollinator declines are impacted by human behavior, which means we're responsible for the declines these pollinators are facing, but it also means that we can change our behavior and start to address these declines in pollinators. And we can do that by conserving and creating habitat, reducing our reliance on pesticides, reducing risk from managed pollinators, and planning for diversity in habitat creation. And when we need to take into effect these efforts at multiple scales. We need to address pollinator decline at large landscape scales and agricultural and big property management systems, all the way down to small scales in our own backyards. And creating habitat that is climate resilient and free of pesticides is something almost anyone with an outdoor space can do to help address multiple issues. Now, considering habitat loss and fragmentation is the leading cause of extinctions, conserving existing habitat and building new habitat in areas where it has been lost is critical to creating new habitat for and addressing these pollinator declines. And the good news is that insects are able to use really small patches of resources and partial habitats that are suitable for foraging and nesting and can move around to them pretty easily because they can fly. So small improvements to habitats may have really dramatic results, at least for some generalist species, like a few different bumblebees species. And if we can convert the non-habitat spaces of our urban areas, such as taking a rock mulch lawn and turning it into a native plant garden, we can really help support local pollinator populations by reversing habitat loss and helping connect the other existing open spaces surrounding our towns and cities. And to create habitat for bees and other insect pollinators, we need to consider the three main elements needed to complete their life cycles, all of which we can provide in our own backyards. So first, they need food, and pollinators visit flowers to feast on nectar and pollen. So including a variety of plants that provide blooms from spring until fall will feed a diversity of pollinators that are active at different times of year. Also including host plants, which are essential for supporting our butterflies and moths. Caterpillars of butterflies and moths are often quite picky about what they eat. They will only eat specific plants. So you're probably familiar, monarch caterpillars will only eat milkweeds. And that's true for a lot of species of butterflies and moths. So including a lot of different native host plants is an important food source you can provide for the larval stage of butterflies and moths. Pollinators also need shelter or nesting and overwintering sites that are not disturbed during their dormant life stage. So most pollinators spend their dormant or overwintering life stage either in the soil, within leaf litter, or in rock and brush piles, or inside the cavities of trees and stems. So creating that undisturbed area for them to survive through the winter or as their dormant stage. And finally, they need safety where they are not exposed to pesticides. And we can protect pollinators by eliminating pesticide use around our homes and ensuring that the plants we buy are not treated with pesticides. And I wanted to take a moment to talk about why native plants are so important when we're creating habitat for pollinators. The quality of food for pollinators is dependent on what available plants are around. So we recommend native plants for a few reasons. Native plants have evolved with our native pollinators in this area. Many pollinators have become specialists with our native plants and will not survive by foraging from introduced plant species. Native plants are also adapted to local environmental conditions of the region, and in the right locations, they can tolerate our really harsh southwest climate better than a lot of non-native ornamental species can. And they've also evolved with the pest of the region. And in evolving with them, they've evolved defenses against those pests. So our native plants can, you know, feed many different pollinator species, but they're also going to be more resilient and hardy against the stress of a changing climate and any local pests that we have. So creating climate resilient pollinator habitat can be integrated into just about any urban conservation initiative you can think of. And in turn, creating pollinator habitat benefits urban communities in a number of ways. So if we consider creating or including pollinator plants, creating pollinator habitat in the form of rain gardens and also improving our open space areas by encouraging higher native vegetation cover, reducing bare ground exposure, we can help decrease stormwater runoff, which will help prevent some erosion, increase water infiltration, and ultimately help with water conservation, which is very critical in the Southwest. If we create pollinator habitat in the form of drought tolerant native trees and shrubs that can provide structural habitat for pollinators, or maybe they're flowering and provide flowering resources for pollinators, these trees and shrubs are also really beneficial to our urban environment by helping with temperature regulation. When we've converted a lot of our land to these really absorbent heat attracting surfaces like concrete and asphalt, that can really create an urban heat island effect where temperatures are higher in an urban area compared to the natural surrounding landscape. So if we include lots of native trees and shrubs that aren't taking up a lot of water, we can help mitigate the impacts of that temperature increase. Also having, you know, larger woody plants like trees and shrubs can help increase property values and improve aesthetics. And of course, this is also very important for shade in the Southwest. I know I need to find it everywhere I go. So our trees and shrubs can also really benefit pollinators and our urban spaces. And if we create pollinator habitat in the form of seed and fruit producing plants, which is just about all pollinator pollinated plants, we can help create resources for wildlife to eat seeds and fruits of native plants here. And also it opens up urban foraging opportunities for our communities. Just be sure to do your research before you eat any urban native plants. And finally, pollinator habitat, if we can create it in the form of accessible public green spaces, this really can help create opportunities for community members to connect with nature by observing plants and animals interacting. It also can provide a space for recreation and relaxation, and also be an area to host outdoor events and outreach. So there are many, many benefits to creating pollinator habitat in an urban area, not just for pollinators themselves, but for the community at large. So in recognizing the value of building pollinator habitat in urban areas, Xerces is excited to launch the Santa Fe Pollinator Trail this year, which is a pilot program for our Urban Pollinator Trails Initiative. And the main goal of the Santa Fe Pollinator Trail is to create connected, climate-resilient habitat. And I want to break down those two elements for you, the connected climate-resilient part. And I'm going to start with what does connected habitat look like? When we develop areas and lose habitat, we also create fragmentation of habitats where movement of wildlife is interrupted and populations can become isolated. A habitat patch is an area with natural resources or a space large enough for a particular species to successfully carry out some part of its life cycle. And how big a patch is needed depends on the species. So a small solitary bee needs a much smaller patch of habitat than something like a black bear would need. And when you look at a landscape from above, you might be able to identify stepping stones or smaller natural areas that can act as refuges or provide resources for plants and animals moving between larger patches. And corridors like stepping stones connect larger patches of habitat to one another, allowing movement from one big patch to the next. And for pollinators, we can work to connect larger patches that support big diverse populations of pollinators and other wildlife by building stepping stones of habitat and connected corridors through our fragmented urban landscape. And this connectivity is really important for allowing bees and plants from one small area to interact and reproduce with bees and plants from other areas. And that helps increase gene flow between populations and helps maintain a healthy genetic diversity over time. Because when small populations become too isolated, they can fall victim to inbreeding and disease. So in densely developed urban areas, some significant habitat patches are usually limited to places like parks, along rivers or arroyos, the edges of the city, and other open spaces. Creating a small patchwork of habitats through a really highly developed landscape. And creating pollinator habitat in neighborhoods between these really developed areas offers a really excellent opportunity to connect those few patches throughout the city and to the surrounding natural areas. So to better understand where potential pollinator habitat exists in Santa Fe and where to best connect these patches, we've been working with a GIS mapping specialist to analyze the land cover and core habitat patch distribution in and around Santa Fe. So this map shows national land cover data with our forest in dark green, our grass and shrublands in light green, and the developed areas in gray. And this data is from satellite imagery and is not the perfect measure of pollinator habitat, but it gives us a really good idea of where we have converted natural vegetation to something else. And you can see Santa Fe itself is surrounded by undeveloped land, and the developed areas of town create a pretty big barrier to pollinators that are trying to move across this landscape. Now, if we look a little closer, we can see some major corridors and small undeveloped patches within this big developed urban matrix of Santa Fe, where there's a lot of kind of natural grass and shrub cover along the Arroyo de los Chamizos to the south, and also along the Santa Fe River to the north. Upstream, it's really surrounded, and downstream, it's really surrounded, but it does cut through this really densely developed area of downtown. And if we include public spaces on this map, which is a little finer scale data, we can see more detail of those habitat patches in the highly developed areas. And if we want to build habitat that bees can move between in Santa Fe, we need to determine how close should we be putting new stepping stones between those existing patches and the surrounding natural landscapes of Santa Fe. So let's take a look at the Rail Yard Park, which is right in downtown in the middle of a highly developed area of Santa Fe as an example. This park has some really excellent areas of flowering native plants in the heart of Santa Fe. And this is one of our existing habitat patches, but it's surrounded by lots of pavement and dense development. But the good news is that pollinators are able to fly and cross a lot of these major barriers to get to other little habitat patches in the area compared to something like the bigger mammal. But how far can they go? That really depends on the bee. So bees with larger body sizes generally have more energy stores and can travel much further for pollen and nectar than smaller bees. Social bees like honeybees and bumblebees will also travel much further than solitary bees. A social bee is able to, you know, take bigger risk because there are other bees in the colony foraging for food, whereas the smaller solitary bees are not replaceable if they're injured or caught in a rainstorm while out foraging. So they're more cautious and stay close to their nest. So when we're thinking about building networks that work for these smaller bees too, and ideally we'd be building habitat in big patches as well as along linear features like rail trails, walking paths, all of those side path areas are able to support pollinator habitat and are easy linear features for pollinators to follow. Now, let's look back at the natural land cover and open space stepping stones in town. And if we consider a really small bee that is only able to forage up to 300 feet from her nest, where can she go in Santa Fe? By looking at the edge of all pollinator habitat, land cover features, and our open space stepping stones, and creating a 300-foot buffer around them, we can see what is easily accessible for this bee. So this map shows that a 300-foot buffer around existing open space and natural vegetation cover highlights the distribution of densely developed areas and how far they are from natural land cover or open space. So where there are gaps in the green kind of shows where those areas are more distant from a natural open space cover compared to the rest of town. Now, if we consider a larger bee that is able to forage up to half a mile from their nest, we have a really different picture. They are able to fly the distance across these highly developed areas where smaller bees couldn't, and access other natural open land covers and open spaces. So if we look at what a half mile buffer looks like, this is showing that no matter where a larger bee is nesting, they are able to fly the distance across those highly developed areas to other natural land covers and open spaces. So no matter where you are in Santa Fe, if you plant pollinator habitat, you're likely to have many pollinator species able to access it and be contributing to pollinator conservation no matter where you are. So now that you have a little bit better of an idea of what connected habitat looks like in Santa Fe, let's talk about this other main piece, the climate resilient part of the pollinator trail. So when we're thinking about plant selection for our pollinator habitats in town, we really are working to encourage the use of climate smart native plants in landscaping. We want to create really lasting habitat that will be able to withstand increasing temperatures and severe drought. So when we're thinking about plant selection, something like thinking about a desert willow is a really great option for the desert Southwest. It's really popular with lots of pollinators. It has these gorgeous showy blooms and it's very drought resilient, where planting it, you know, a few decades ago, it's kind of on the edge of it being too cold in Santa Fe. But now with our increasing temperatures and our more extreme droughts, this is a really great option for planting trees in Santa Fe. So to create this climate resilient connected habitat and inform our community about how to support pollinators, we really need the help of our partners within the community to build and maintain pollinator habitat in public spaces, and also to help host educational events and share resources at accessible public spaces. And fortunately, Santa Fe is home to so many incredible urban conservation organizations who have really been instrumental in supporting this pollinator trail project. And with these wide-reaching partnerships, we will incorporate pollinator habitat into existing gardens, parks, trail sides, nature preserves, and other public spaces that these groups manage, and also support outreach and each other's urban conservation initiatives in the city. So we have a lot of, I don't have every single partner that we have logos on here, but we are always open to new partners. So please contact me if you would like to work with the Pollinator Trail. And finally, as part of the Santa Fe Pollinator Trail, we are offering native pesticide-free plants through a Habitat Kit program. So the Habitat Kit program, we're offering a kit of native pollinator plants to residents as well as local organizations that manage open public space. And these kits are intended for use in urban Santa Fe to help improve that pollinator habitat connectivity. So if you're really far outside Santa Fe, you're probably not eligible for a habitat kit, but if you're within Santa Fe, you could potentially get one. So Xerces is covering the cost of the kit, and participants must sign a project partner collaborative agreement stating that they will provide the time, labor, and space to establish these plants in their yards or in public gardens throughout urban Santa Fe. So who are the kits for exactly? The kits will be available for residential use by homeowners and by renters to use in their yards and gardens where they live. We just ask that renters please have a conversation with your landlord or property manager and get permission to plant these plants. Kits are also available for use in public spaces that are managed by an organization or an institution or agency, such as schoolyards, libraries, parks, public gardens, or nature preserves. And one thing, if you would like a kit, you do need to have a couple of things. You need to have irrigation. Establishing these plants will require a little bit of water in the first few years, and also enough space to plant a full kit. One kit needs approximately 300 square feet. But please keep in mind that that space does not need to be contiguous. You can plant part of the kit in your front yard, part in your side yard, another part in the backyard, but you can't split it up to different properties. But you need approximately 300 square feet total across your property to plant it. So if you're interested in participating in the Habitat Kit program, you will need to fill out an interest form by June 30th. Those will be on our website. I'll tell you where to find them. And if you are selected, you have to sign a project partner collaborative agreement, which just ensures that you understand some of the responsibilities of the kit. So interest forms are due by June 30th. You'll be contacted in July if you're selected to sign the collaborative agreement, which will just cover those basic requirements, including acknowledging that you are responsible for picking up your kit between September 24th and 26th in Santa Fe, and you'll plant them within 2 weeks of picking them up by October 10th. And also committing to submit some follow-up information to Xerces about your Habitat Kit planting next year in summer 2022. So we're just asking for some basic things like photos of your planted Habitat Kit, how many plants in the kit survived, and any pollinator observations you might have seen. So what is in a Habitat Kit? A kit consists of climate smart, pesticide-free pollinator plants with a diversity of species that will provide blooms from spring to fall. And these are all grown by the Santa Ana Native Plant Nursery. And a total of 350 kits are available for both residential and public space use. And one kit contains one flat of 32 small transplants of perennial wildflowers, plus one small tree or shrub species in a 1 gallon pot, plus a pollinator habitat sign. And just to give you an idea of what a flat looks like, these trays in this bottom picture, this first tray, you can see there's four 2-inch pots across one side and a total of 32 small transplants in a tray. So that's one kit plus the bigger shrub or small tree. And we have two kit types. So I'm gonna describe what those look like quickly. There's a low water kit and a low to medium water kit. So for the low water kit species, we have one small tree, the New Mexico olive, so that can get up to 15 feet, a spread of almost 12 feet. So please keep in mind that's kind of a bigger tree. The rest of the species are all species that will do really well without much supplemental watering. And it includes things like a cactus. We've got lots of and encouraging or including lots of things that will bloom from early to late in the year. This kit is kind of ideal for those areas that might be in full sun, that are south facing or really dry areas. So looking at what blooms will be provided by this different set of species in the low water kit, we have the New Mexico olive, which is flowering right now, a little inconspicuous, spring blooming tree, and then evening primrose, the prickly pear, upright prairie coneflower, purple prairie clover, blackfoot daisy, chocolate flower, copper globe mallow, and threadleaf groundsel. And for the low to medium water kit species, we have the first, the early blooming species is the shrub. It's a three-leaf sumac. They don't get quite as tall as the New Mexico olive, but they can get pretty wide. So please keep that in mind. And then an assortment of wildflower species. A couple of those species need just a little extra water than the others. So looking at those, we have three-leaf sumac, early blooming. We've got Rocky Mountain penstemon, and showy milkweed is one of those that will need a little bit extra water. Then we have white prairie clover, hairy false golden aster, kota, bee balm. Bee balm is also one that will need like a little bit more water, maybe planted on the north side of the house in a wetter area. Then verbena McDougall, or McDougall verbena, and blanket flower. So please keep in mind the flowers that I just showed you, that's not what you're going to get quite yet. So you'll be getting very small baby plants. They probably won't have any flowers on them yet. So when you pick them up in late September, they will be small and need to be carefully planted after you pick them up and will require regular watering for the next two or more years until their roots are well established. So please consider that this is a little bit of a time commitment and that you'll be nurturing those plants until they're large and robust and provide lots of blooms in the years to come. Participants will also receive guidance for planting and watering and maintenance of your habitat kit. So if you're concerned about what gardening knowledge you have, you will receive some guidance. And while I wish we could give habitat kits to everyone who fills out an interest form, we do have a limited number and we can't guarantee kits to any one person or public space. So just to give you an idea, the residential participant selection for habitat kits will be based primarily on location. We are really focusing on improving connectivity of habitat, of pollinator habitat in urban Santa Fe. So please apply if you're not in these kind of red areas. We definitely wanna spread these habitat kits out throughout the city, but we will prioritize those highly densely developed areas. And for public space participant selection, that will be based mostly on the outreach potential of the habitat kit and how accessible the planting location is for people. So will lots of people see it? Will students see it? Is it really easily accessible to the general public? That kind of stuff. So if you're interested in participating in the Habitat Kit program, please visit our Habitat Kit website to see our webpage that has FAQs and the links to the interest forms and a lot more. There's the URL, but if you just go to xerces.org and hit the search magnifying glass, you can just type in Habitat Kits and you'll find it. And just keep in mind, interest forms are due June 30th. So you have a little while if you need to do some research. So this is kind of our first step in launching the Santa Fe Pollinator Trail by opening up our interest forms and having this webinar. But there's a lot to come in the coming months. So we're hoping to create a series of guidance and resource documents, including that habitat kit care and maintenance document. We're hoping to create a recommendations for how to add additional habitat species to your yard, guidance for creating nesting and overwintering habitat, and creating articles on different topics of conversation from our partners that are specialized in those topics. We'll also be creating a brochure with the Santa Fe Pollinator Trail with a map and some basic information on the trail. Well, we're also hoping to have a website and a place where you can pledge to add your habitat to the Santa Fe map. So if you don't get a habitat kit and you still have really great habitat to share, you can, similar to our pollinator protection pledge, add your pollinator habitat to the map and sign a pledge that you will commit to providing safe, climate resilient habitat. And I just wanna take a moment to talk about other amazing conservation initiatives happening in Santa Fe. So just recently, Bee City Santa Fe resolution passed through City Council, and we're working on developing a website where we can share lots of this information specific to Santa Fe. Santa Fe County also passed a pollinator protection resolution, so there's already really great pollinator conservation work happening at local government entities. There's also some really cool urban tree initiatives happening, like Tree Smart Santa Fe and the Santa Fe Community Network, the Next Generation Water Summit with the Water Conservation Office of the city is happening in early June. There's an eco art exhibit happening at the Rail Yard Park. This week is Earth Week, pollinator, or Earth Day is the 22nd. So there's lots of really exciting events happening around conservation in urban Santa Fe. And Xerces is really excited to join the many conservation organizations working to make Santa Fe a more sustainable, pollinator-friendly city, and we hope you'll join us. So if you'd like some more information, you can visit xerces.org to find a lot of resources and different webpage on different topics on pollinator conservation. We have a few books that provide really detailed guidance for creating habitat in your yard and on farms. We have lots of fact sheets, brochures, guidelines, and reports you can download and print out on our website, lots of cool publications. You can also find other webinars and other videos on our YouTube channel. This webinar is being recorded and will be uploaded to our YouTube channel in a few days. So if you'd like to share this with your neighbors, please do. You can connect with us at Xerces Society on Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram. And with that, I just want to thank you for attending and your interest in pollinators. And if I don't get to your questions today, please feel free to email me at kaitlin.haase@xerces.org.
Thanks so much, Kaitlin. We've had a couple of questions come in. And if anyone else has questions, please feel free to type them into the Q&A box at the bottom. So our first question came from Rebecca. I put down weed barrier and gravel or bark in places in my yard where I had weed problems back when it used to rain. Does that interfere with bees?
So our ground nesting bees, they do need access to the ground, the soil, in order to create some, to be able to access the soil and dig down and create a nesting habitat. So weed barrier, if it's not really expansive, it's still good for helping you create good pollinator habitat that's water conservation conscious and helping reduce any kind of invasive species intrusion into your habitat. But, for making sure that there is some accessible soil to the ground in some part of your yard is helpful. But yeah, it's fine in moderation, I would say.
Great. We have a question from Peter. How do you know if the plants you're buying are free of neonicotinoids?
That's a really good question. So the best thing you can do is really ask your nursery. I don't know if you have any input on this, Emily, being a pesticide program expert, but having a conversation with your nursery grower is one of the best things you can do.
Yeah, I can jump in here. I forgot to introduce myself, but I am a pollinator conservation specialist with the pesticide program at Xerces. So we actually just launched a nursery campaign came out with a whole bunch of new resources for empowering consumers to talk to their nurseries about pesticide practices and pest management practices. So if you're interested in that, you can go to our website, to our resource section, and those are called Buying Be Safe Nursery Plants, which is the consumer focused fact sheet with info on how you can talk to your nursery about their practices. And then there's one on offering Be Safe Plants, which is more from the nursery perspective when they're purchasing from a production nursery and selling it at a retail nursery. The purpose of these habitat kits, we had that conversation with Santa Ana Native Plant Nursery, and they do not use pesticides in the production of their plants and in the production of these habitat kits. So they will be coming pesticide free, but it is a really common practice to use systemic insecticides in growing nursery plants. So those are the ones that are water soluble, taken up by the plant and expressed in pollen and nectar. So it is really important to make sure that what you're putting in your yard isn't going to be accidentally harmful to pollinators. Okay, we've got a question from Isabel. Is it possible to get a pollinator habitat sign without a kit and possibly earlier than the fall?
Yes, so we do have our pollinator habitat signs available in English and in Spanish at our Gift Center webpage. So if you go to xerces.org and find our Gift Center, it's a donation-based kind of purchase. So it's a donation to Xerces and a habitat sign. So if you're interested, you can check that out on our website.
Yeah, I think we are hoping to make some signs available at lower cost or for free in Santa Fe for folks who aren't on the trail, who aren't receiving a habitat kit but want to be part of the trail, but we haven't worked out the details of that yet. But if you follow along with us on the project, we'll make sure that we keep that up to date. Dorothy asks, is there any way to educate local nurseries so they can set up a habitat kit section for sale to customers? Customers could more easily find appropriate plant combinations if nurseries can group them in this way, and an educational flyer could be included with the purchase.
Yeah, so there's definitely a lot of talk with the Bee City Santa Fe group about working to create something like this, working specifically with local Santa Fe nurseries. So I'm on the committee for the Santa Fe Bee City, so I'll definitely be helping create that kind of guidance. But specifically, habitat kits that we're providing are they're grown wholesale, so they're not available for public purchase. But yeah, I'm definitely interested in working with the local nurseries and providing that guidance at the nursery to buy an assortment of pollinator plants that will provide that blooming from spring to fall, but in order to support a wide diversity of species.
There's a related question from Amy, which is, for those who want to create habitat in their yard and are willing to buy the plants in the kits, will you have a list on your website of the plants in the habitat kits with instructions?
Yes, so right now the list is available online on our habitat kit webpage. Instructions or guidance for growing and maintenance is yet to be developed. But that will be on our website once, and you can find it there.
And there is actually a larger list that Kaitlin developed last year of plants for the general Santa Fe and Albuquerque area, which has I think 24 species on it. So if you're interested in getting started, there's also sort of a larger list to work from if you are interested in broadening out to more species. Robert wanted to point out that the city is celebrating Arbor Day with a tree planting celebration on National Arbor Day, which is April 30th at 4 p.m. at Rancho del Sol Park, which is off of Avenida Contenta and Jaguar Drive. So thanks for pointing that out in the comments. Okay, we've got a couple of pesticide questions. Does spraying pinyon for scale with mineral oil have a negative effect on pollinators? And I guess maybe I can take this one.
You're the pro.
That one, I'd have to look at sort of the timing of when the application occurs. Mineral oil or horticultural oils in general are a smothering agent. So they affect sort of soft insects or insects that they basically smother them out by causing them to not, you know, get clogged up and not be able to breathe. So they are useful in treating insects like scale. And if they're being sprayed at a time when pollinators are not present, and I don't think, pinyon is going to be attractive to pollinators all the way through the year, then you're probably going to be able to get away with that without having a major negative impact on pollinators. Once the oil is on the plant, it's not going to be toxic to pollinators. It's just when it's like completely smothered an insect that it is, that it's harmful to them. So it's anything that would be on the plant at the time of application. So that's unlike something like a systemic insecticide that would be expressed for a long period of time through that plant, like a neonic. So hope that answers your question. There's another question also about conifers treated with pesticides. So are most conifers in the nursery trade treated with pesticides before they're sold? And I live in Denver and wanted to add some conifers for birds. This is, again, something to talk with your nursery about. It is really common to treat all kinds of different plants in the nursery trade with systemics for scale, for aphids, for other sucking insects, as well as with fungicides to take care of different kind of mildew issues and whatnot. So it's worth having that conversation with your nursery, because you can make a pretty good assumption that if it's a big conventional nursery, that it probably is using some kind of pesticide in its production. Okay, we've got a few more here. Other good plants are Palmer's penstemon and catmint. Those are, I think Palmer's penstemon might be on that larger list you created.
I think I have Rocky Mountain penstemon. Palmer penstemon is great too. Just to not have a list inundated with penstemon, I went with Rocky Mountain. But yes, Palmer's penstemon is great. Catmint, catnip. There's a lot of herbal flowering herbs that are really, really great pollinator plants. New Mexico State University has a few documents related to what can really bring in lots of pollinators based on that subsection of herbal plants, and catnips on there and mints are on there.
And then I think this, there's only a couple left. I have a tree stump. I want to make it into a bee house. What size and how deep should the holes be?
That's a good question. I think maybe you can correct me if I'm wrong on this, Emily, but creating a diversity of hole sizes and depths can ensure that you're creating space for a diversity of bees. So a lot of those stem nesting, tunnel nesting bees are quite picky about what size they'll use, what depth they'll use. So if you try and incorporate a lot of options for them, then you'll probably have a few more takers.
Yeah, that's a great answer. There's bees like to have a hole size that is about the same size as their thorax, so that when they go into the hole, they get like mites, pollen mites, and other things that have hopped on for the flight that get scraped off. and they don't bring them into the nest with them. So it really depends on the body size of the bee. So having a variety of hole sizes down from, I think a quarter inch up to a half an inch would probably be a good size range. One more. I have a number of gophers that are digging around all sorts of plants. Are plants in the low water kit something they would like to eat?
Ooh, yeah, that's a good question. I have heard gophers will enjoy cacti, and there is a prickly pear cacti in that kit. The other species, I'm not entirely sure about. But yeah, that is a risk you can take by seeing what is eaten by gophers versus what might not be. But yeah, I know it's a really, once you have gophers, it's really hard to keep a good garden established because they are voracious and are happy to eat them when you plant them.
Yeah. Okay. We did actually have one more question, then I'll cut it off after that. As the climate changes and it gets warmer, will plants produce flowers at a time when pollinators are not available?
So that is a really good question and something that scientists are trying to answer currently. And it will depend on a lot of environmental factors, but we are seeing a lot of plants blooming much earlier in different parts of the world. And that timing difference of when plants are blooming earlier versus when insects are cued to emerge in different climate situations, there is that risk of that disconnect happening when some things are emerging versus are they emerging too late after something's flowered? So it is a concern, but if we include a big diversity of plants that are flowering at different times of year, then we can probably help mitigate that. That's something scientists are definitely trying to answer. And it's happening in some situations for sure.
Great. Thank you so much, Kaitlin. Thanks everyone for your great questions. So please do reach out to us if you're interested in partnering on this project. If you have trouble getting access to the interest form or anything else, feel free to reach out and get in touch. And thanks so much, Kaitlin, for leading us through it.